On this channel, I've been doing mostly bare metal stuff. You know, the videos about the Raspberry Pi and the Pico, and those have been great because when you're working with the bare metal, there's nothing in between you and the hardware. You know, you can use all the memory you want, you can use whatever core you want or any peripheral you want, and you really have full control of your machine. There's nothing getting in your way. But personal computers are they're different. Desktops and laptops have these thing called operating systems, which their entire job is to get in your way and yell at you. Kind of like your mom. She just walks in your room, just starts yelling at you, trying to get you to do stuff. But so operating systems, at their core, they have this thing called the kernel. The kernel is really like the base of the operating system, and the kernel is just an abstraction of the hardware. The kernel just makes it easy to do things like use the USB ports and get inputs and stuff. You know, like without the kernel, every application would have to pretty much write a device driver just to get use the keyboard. But so that is a convenience. But when you're living under the kernel's roof, you have to follow the kernel's rules, which means that when you want to use memory, you have to allocate it. You have to use what's called a syscall, a system call, which is kind of like a function from the kernel. It tells the kernel, hey, can you do this for me? And it's just like a function you write in like a C program. You know, it has function parameters, it takes arguments, it has a return value, and so you use like a syscall to like allocate memory. You have to use a syscall to open a file. You have to use a syscall to write to a file. And you know you and if you you get out of bounds, you try to access memory you don't have access to, it's seg faults. You know, like you never see a seg fault on a Pico, because there's no system to yell at you. You know, you own all the memory, but with an operating system, it divides the memory. It allocates memory, certain parts of the memory, to different processes, and the memory you have isn't even like the real memory. It's called virtual memory, which means that it kind of has like a fake address, and the kernel, whenever you access memory, takes your fake address and then translate into a physical address via the memory table. But I figured out a workaround. There's a way for you to kind of skip this skip one of the kernel's rules, and kind of really have this low-level control of executing code. You know how usually when you execute code on Linux, you have to use an ELF file, the executable linkable format, which contains information regarding how to like load it into memory, how to execute it. And I'm not a fan of ELF files. They're a bit obsolete in my opinion. Has a lot of legacy stuff attached to it, but there's a system call called execve that Linux takes a path to a ELF file and execute it, and that's how pretty much all files are executed on Linux. Pretty much everything has to be in an ELF format, but there's a way to execute a code without the ELF format, and that's what I'm going to show you. So let's first write some assembly. It can be whatever. Let's make a simple program that it just pushes. So yeah, let's do this. Let's print something to the console. So let's push. We need to do it this backwards. We first need to push zero, our null terminator. Then let's push. What's the Fuck, it's 10. That's the new line character. And then let's push the money symbol, which is 36, I believe. I hope that's it. Yeah, the dollar sign is decimal value 36. So we push this on the stack, and now we have to make a system call to print this on the stack. So the system call we're going to use is write. So the system call to write takes three arguments. The first argument is your file descriptor you're writing to. The second argument is a pointer to the string you want to print. And then the third argument is the size of the number of characters you want to print, basically the number of bytes, the size of bytes of your string. So with any system call, the first argument goes into RDI. So we're going to move 1 into RDI because the file descriptor, basically when we print anything to console, the console, the terminal uses, its output is what's known as standard out. So like whenever, like, and when you're writing a C program and you printf, what that really means is print to standard out. And that's, standard out is one of the three standard files that any application has. So file descriptor 0 is standard in. That's how you get inputs. File descriptor 1 is standard out. And then file descriptor 2 is standard error. But we only care about standard out since we're just printing a character. So we're moving 1 into RDI. And then because we pushed the stuff on the stack, that means the stack pointer points to the beginning of our little string, which is just the dollar sign, a new line character, and a null terminator. So then we move, the second argument goes to RSI, so we move the stack pointer into RSI, and then we need to give it the number of bytes, and that goes into RDX. So into RDX, we move 3, because we have 1, 2, 3 bytes. So then we need to actually specify what system call we're making. And the write system call is actually the second system call. And counting starts as everything. In computer science, it starts with 0. So we move the system call number goes into RAX, R-A-X, and we're moving 1. So 1 is the number for the write system call. And then we just do syscall, which is how our program actually tells the kernel, hey, I'm calling you, this is the information. And then we need to tell it to exit, since every program is responsible for exiting properly. So we move 0 into RDI, and that's just, it's just good practice to always exit your program with an exit code of 0. That just means there weren't any problems. We exited properly. And then the syscall number to exit is 60. So then we move 60 into RAX. And now we can make our exit system call. And this is our little program that we're going to load into memory. So let's write this. And now we can assemble it. So, and on one of my videos back, one of the Pico videos, I got a comment about my development environment. So I'm using my own little, I call it the AU Assembler. It's a little project I'm working on. And it's just an architecture agnostic assembler, common syntax. So I can do both ARM assembly and x86 assembly in a familiar syntax. It's available on GitHub. It's kind of in early development, so I wouldn't say it's ready for regular use yet. But use it if you want to, though I recommend sticking to the GNU assembler for now. But yeah, I'll use my own assembler, AU, and then our architecture is x86-64, and our file is a.s, and let's put this into a.bin. So now, if we, let's open this up and actually look at the machine code. So if we translate this to a hex file, and now we can open that up, and here is our code. So here we are pushing our values on the stack. We push 0, we push 10, and then we push 36. So here's our push, and then we this is our move instruction. So yeah, here are move instructions. Where does this end? Yeah, here we go. So we have move 1 into RDI, we move RSP into RSI, and then we move 3 into RDI, RDX. And then, where's our syscall? Here's, so syscalls are always going to be 0F0A in hex. And then same story down here. So this is the equivalent machine code for our assembly. So I'm not going to actually rip this apart and show you kind of disassemble it, but these are the bytes that we have to load into memory to execute a program. So let's get to the magic. Let's close this out and create a C file. Let's go nvim and I'm going to call it execbin.c. And as always, let's get our libraries. So I'm going to use standard int.h. Let's just get a couple of the standard libraries. I'm going to need standard lib. String.h. And then I also it's also good to have uni standard. This has some system call stuff. And let's get standard IO. Do we need standard? Yeah, let's not use standard IO. I don't think we'll need it. And then let's go. We need some stuff for syscalls, so let's get our sched.h. This is for our scheduler. We're gonna need file control.h, and then we'll need sys/mman.h. This is important. And then we'll need sys, oh, not h, not g. sys/stat.h, and then we'll need sys/, let's go types.h, I think that probably has some important stuff. So those are the headers we're gonna need. So before we actually start digging in, let me explain how memory and processes work on Linux. So every time you open a process, you or open a thread, you go to the CPU scheduler, which is responsible for kind of orchestrating all the processes running at the same time. So if we want to actually look at like all the processes running, let's open up a new tab, a new terminal. Let's take a look at HTOP. So here, everything's organized with its PID, its processor ID. So every process has its own ID, and it's increments. So every time you start a new process, it gets a new ID. So here we have PID 1, which is our kernel init script, and then we have a bunch of kernel threads. All the gray stuff is kernel threads, and then our first user process is systemd. So systemd is my init system. I know, cringe, but yes, so we have systemd, and then systemd opens up my window manager, and then these are all the threads for my window manager, and then it opens up stuff like background, sway idle, my status bar, and then it goes down the list, and kind of this is how the system is initialized. So yeah, here my this is my screen recorder I'm using to make this video. Here's the terminal I just opened up, the bash instance for that terminal, and then I have my HTOP that I literally just called. So HTOP is the last process I created, so it has the highest PID. And you can also look at stuff like virtual memory, resident memory. I'm not really going to go into that today, but that's kind of how processes work. And this is all managed by the CPU scheduler. It schedules how everything runs simultaneously. So as far as memory, I've sure you've heard the phrase everything in Unix is a file, and that extends to the our idea memory. So whenever we allocate memory, we allocate it as if we're opening up a file on our hard drive. So we need a file descriptor just with a standard out, and we use that descriptor to kind of like say, hey, we are creating a new file, and we are using this file to then allocate memory, which is attached to this file. Now you don't actually have to, as once you have the memory, you don't actually need the file part anymore. You can just throw that away. But there's a system called mmap, which is pretty much like, I'd say, one of the most important syscalls there is. You need it to allocate memory. You need it to read and write files. The mmap, it just maps memory. Yeah, just it does that. Maps memory. Doesn't need much further explanation, but you'll see how it works in a second. So let's create our main function, and let's int 32t arg c, int 8t asterisk asterisk arg v. So here are our standard arguments, and as always, we return 0. So you can kind of connect the C to assembly. This just gets the system call to exit, and 0 is our return value. So that's our exit code. So let's open up our file. So we'll need int32tfd. This will be our file descriptor, and let's open up. Takes two arguments. We'll open up whatever argv is. So let's say that's our that's the command parameter for the file we want to execute. We'll go argv1, and then we need to give it some flags. So the only flag I'm going to use is O read only, since we don't actually need to write to this file. It just contains the binary. It just contains what we're loading into memory, so we're only reading it. So let's just read it, and then once we open that, we can get the size of it. So let's go struct stat, and let's go fs. So this is our oh, we need fstat. So what is that? Slish, yeah, sys slash stat slish. Oh wait, oh, fuck, I'm dumb as shit. I already have that. So now we can go fstat, our file descriptor, and then a pointer to our status struct. And now we have this will contain the size of our file, which is important. So now we can get the actual binary. So let's just create a block of bytes called bin, and now we'll get to call the make the big call. We get to go mmap, and mmap has a bunch of arguments. So the first one is kind of where we want to allocate this memory, but we don't really care. We're just going to ask the kernel for whatever you got. So we'll just give it 0, null. And then we need to give it our the size of the number of bytes we're allocating. So we'll go fs dot st underscore size, and that is the size of the file we just read. And then we need to give it some flags. So let's go prot read. So this just tells the kernel that when you create the memory, it only has a read protection. So that just means that we can read from it. If you're writing to it, you'll need prot underscore write, and if you're executing, you need prot underscore exec. So that's another thing about Linux, which I'm not the biggest fan of, is that there's a lot of memory protections. You know, we don't have this on the bare metal. But after we give it that flag, we need to specify the visibility. So we'll go map private, because no one else is using this but us. And then we give it the file descriptor we're allocating this memory from, and then give it 0. This is just our offset into the file, but we don't actually care about, since we're just reading from the very beginning. So we're just giving an offset of 0. and now we don't need that file anymore. So let's close FD. And now bin contains our, that contains our binary. So now we need to allocate the memory that we're actually going to be executing from. Since this is only read-only, but we need to create memory that we can give to a thread and execute it. So then let's create a, first we'll need a new function. So if you watch my Wayland video, it was like a week or two ago. I should have mentioned this earlier. We actually used mmap to create our buffer memory, and like creating buffers in Wayland is kind of a painful process. But there is a function I created there that we'll actually need here. So, and that is a way to allocate a shared memory file. So when we want to just create memory out of the blue, we still need a file descriptor, but the question is, where do we get a file descriptor from? So let's allocate some shared memory, and it'll take a parameter of size, and if I remember the code correctly, it was like, I had this name, so a string, and then, the first byte has to be a slash, just because, just like our, there's no slash the other way. It's just like any file on Linux has to, it starts at root. And then we, the very last byte has to be a null terminating character. So now I need to create a random name. Just like we did in the Wayland video. So we'll just create an index of 0, and then if it's less than 7, we'll increment it. And then we'll just load a random lowercase letter into the name. So let's just go rand and 23. So this will be letters A through, W or something. And we'll add 97 since that is ASCII to A. And now we need to create our file. So int32tfd equals, and you can use either open or shim open. I'll just use shim open since that's what I use in the Wayland video. Since this won't actually be a file on the drive. This is only going to exist in memory, so we give it our name, and then we need to read and write from it, and then if it doesn't exist, in which case, like, it won't exist since this is just a random file name, we need to say, if it doesn't exist, create it, and then we'll need to truncate it to 0, since we don't want we want it to have no size. And then we'll need to specify that the user has both write and read privileges. And let's just leave it at that. That should be sufficient. And then we can truncate that to the size. And now we can return our file descriptor. So this function will just make a file descriptor out of the blue. So now that we're done with that mess, let's get back to business. So we go fd allocate shared memory, and let's specify a size. So let's say we have a size of fs dot size plus, and this is where we get to pick our stack size. So let's just give it a stack size of we're not using much. Let's just go 1024. That's a quarter of a page, and that's another thing I'm not really getting into. But Linux kind of organizes memory into these thing called pages, And again, that's one of the design aspects of Linux I don't really care for. I think it's a bit obsolete. Its pages were big back in like the 60s and 70s for when hardware was slower. But anyway, so 1024, that's going to be the size of the stack we allocate. So we need, whenever we create a process, we also need to create a stack for that process. But I'm just going to allocate both the program memory and the stack memory in one big block. Typically, this program will split up into two different, typically a process splits it up into two different blocks, but we don't actually care about that. So now let's go, oh, I forgot to give it a variable name, size. So now we go size. So now we have a file of that size, and now we can create our actual memory in memory. This is where we're executing from. So let's go unt mem. And we get to use mmap again, zero size. And it has as a little more a little less protection actually. So now we can write and we'll give it exec. So now we can execute it. And this will be our file descriptor and then zero offset. So now we have our memory mapped. So now all we need to do to copy our binary into memory, manually load the binary into memory, we just use memcopy, just like from standard string. So our destination is mem. We're getting it from bim, and we'll go fs dot st underscore size. So we're just loading this entire file into memory. So now our binary is in memory, which means we are in full control to actually execute it. But before I do that, oh, forgot to close this. So close FD since we don't need that anymore. And now we can, once we load the binary into memory, we don't need it anymore. So, typically when you're writing C and you allocate memory, you use malloc and free. But without the C standard library, we just use mmap and unmap. So we're going to unmap bin with bin and then fs.st underscore size. So this unmaps the binary from memory. So now the only thing from our program in memory is this mem. So now we get to make the big system call, which is clone. So clone is typically used to create threads for an application. So to like if you're using a POSIX system, won't go into that, but you get this library called pthreads, which makes it easy to create multi-threaded applications. Though it uses this syscall when you get low level, it uses a syscall called clone, which kind of clones your process and then starts at a function. So usually clone, it wants to give you a function. It wants a function pointer from you, and it starts the thread at that function pointer. But we're not going to use a function pointer since we have some we have a binary already in memory. So let's as I said before, every process has a PID. So let's create a I think it's 32, whatever. In 32 PID, and then we get to make our clone system call. So clone is going to expect a function pointer, an address of a function. So I'm not going to go into function pointers too much, but basically like every, just like a variable, if you're familiar with pointers in C, every variable has an address. Functions also have addresses. So just as variables exist in memory, so do functions. So like this alloc underscore shim, this exists in memory as machine code, and that memory has an address. So whenever you call that function, you're basically going back to that address and then executing code. But we're not going to actually give it a pointer to a function we've written. We're going to give it the address of our memory we loaded, which contains our binary. So we give our mem and then it expects a address to the stack. So every process needs a stack to start up. So I mentioned that the size of our memory is the binary size plus our stack size. So typically, if you're familiar with, I'm sure you've heard the phrase like the stack grows downward, something like that. And usually like there's a diagram of like you have like your code down here and your stack up here, and then the stack grows downwards towards your program. And that's like half true. In reality, your stack will most likely be a different block of memory. So you have like two different blocks of memory. You have your code and you have your stack. But for simplicity's sake, we're just going to use a single block of memory. And there's going to be no space in between the stack space and the program space. It's all going to be kind of smushed together. So it's going to go mem plus size. So the stack grows downwards. We're going to start at the very top of our memory. And then we need to give it some flags. So we have to go... You don't really need to give any flags, but just so my process doesn't run away, I'm going to give it clone vfork. So this just says the parent... So this is the parent process, and we're creating a child process. And this just tells the parent process, wait until the child gives you an exit code before you finish. And this is so our parent doesn't, because right after this, we're going to return. So this is so the parent doesn't exit before the child does, which then forces the child to exit. So we want to give the child some time to execute its code. So we'll clone vfork, and then we'll just give it a zero. This is just the arguments to our function, but we're not giving any arguments. We'll just give it zero. And then we'll, let's just print out our processor ID. So let's just go i/n and pip. And if this prints out a negative one, that means we failed to create a new thread. But that shouldn't happen. So now let's, after all this, so this should only execute after our code's done executing. So after that, we can then unmap mem. So now the only thing left to do is to write and compile this. So let's go gcc exec bin and then exec bin.c. So this is the part of the video where I address my various mistakes. So first we need to define GNU source. And don't ask me what this does, but we need to do this so we can have our clone function. Now, some weird mistakes. This should be exclusive, not truncate, since we're truncating right here. Let's see. This should be solved. We do need standard out. Got a little too cocky in the beginning. So standard io.h. What else? We forgot our memory privilege down here. Our memory visibility. And let's just create, let's just make this shared. We're not trying to hide this from anyone. And if you're using like a, if you're making a shared library, you'll need to do this so other applications can access your memory. But I think that should be good. So does it compile? So where are we at? Here I am. F, of course I misspelled truncate. Truncatate. All right, so now the only thing it's yelling at us about is the fact that we didn't give it a function pointer. We just gave it a random memory address. And we can ignore this since it's still gonna work. So now, all right, one more change to mention. This should be a 6 instead of a 7, and you want to unlink your shared memory. Also, you want two more flags. So share with read and write with others. This is just because this is shared memory. But other than that, this is we're set. So now we can compile this. So exec bin, and then let's go exec bin.c, and now we can run it and give it our binary. So a.bin, and there you have it. We're in business. So yeah, this is how you manually load and execute memory on Linux. And one more thing that I think would be cool to look at. Let's hold this program up. So let's just say while one. So now this will just go on until we kill it. So now when we execute this, let's and by the way, this is our processor ID right here. So now when we look for our thread, so here is the process we just created. So this is our parent process and this is our child process. So our and it's in zombie mode right now since it finished executing. It sent the return code, but it still needs to wait for its parent to die. So we have PID 3033 right here. And yeah, this is how you kind of skip past the dumb exec ve system call and just load your code straight into memory.